And welcome. Can local media help save democracy? Which is the title of our panel discussion today. Welcome from me, Michael Scott, in Oxford in the UK, and from my joint convener, Sanford J. Ungar in Washington, DC, to this, the 24th jointly promoted event between the Future of the Humanities Project and the Free Speech Project. The latter is sponsored by Georgetown University and the former by Georgetown's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute for Human Dignity, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. Together, the two projects consider issues concerning human dignity, rights, cultures, histories, traditions, and freedoms in a wide spectrum of educational activity, policy, expression, and aspiration. In a moment, I'll hand over to Sandy, who is director of the Free Speech Project. He will introduce today's distinguished guests and moderate the ensuing discussion before I return to chair the question and answer session towards the end. From the start, you can type in questions to the panel by using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Please do not use the chat button, but the Q&A button. These questions will come to me during the session, and I will try to put them in some kind of coherent order for the panel to consider. We each ask you to ask your questions as and when they occur to you so that there is not a backlog at the end. So with that, I'm looking forward to the discussion. Over to you, Sandy.
Nice to be with you again, Mike. And we're celebrating our own little second anniversary today of these monthly programs. So it's been an artifact of the pandemic continuing, we hope, well beyond. I'll introduce our panelists today in alphabetical order. Stuart Allen is Professor of Journalism and Communication at Cardiff University in Wales, and much of his research revolves around the changing dynamics of war, conflict, and crisis reporting, including both professional and citizen reportage. Citizen reportage is something we may want to get to a little bit later on. Jim Brady, whom we all think of as a pioneer in digital news, he is Vice President for Journalism Programs at the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. And in important disclosure, we should say that the Knight Foundation was the founding funder of the Free Speech Project here at Georgetown University and is continuing to support us. Jim put the Washington Post online for the first time some years back. He led Digital First Media and launched a company that built online local news sites in three American cities. It's well known and identified with the revival of local media in this country. Maria Power is a senior research fellow in human dignity at the Las Casas Institute for Social Justice that Mike mentioned just a short time ago. She is the author of two books on religion in Northern Ireland and has looked a great deal at how journalistic institutions portray public crises. Just this morning in the Washington Post, I might note, one of the senior overview reporters of the Post said that a number of Western democracies are experiencing democratic leaders who are drawn to authoritarianism and are beginning to imitate Vladimir Putin in Russia. So that sort of frames the problem that we're aiming to talk about today, which is who's going to help save democracy, who's going to stand up. And we think, as in many other cases and in many parts of the world, that the media, the news media, have some particular responsibility there. So, Jim, I wanted to start with you with this question of the evolution of local media and whether they are truly great defenders, have always been great defenders, and are now still great defenders of durable democratic values in the United States in particular.
Well, I certainly think they have been over their long history. I think the last 20 years have been a real challenge. I think the ability to do the kind of reporting that strengthens democracy has been eroded pretty dramatically by the business model changes of, that have hammered local media. So I do think if you look at, you know, I don't know that I would say like local media is a defender of democracy in a rah-rah way. I think they're a defender of it by doing the work, by going out and covering government institutions and those who have power and holding them accountable. And I think we kind of, you know, historically have strengthened those sort of democratic pillars rather than just more cheer for democracy. But I think that's why, to me, the getting local media back on its feet is such a crucial, it's the crucial part of my job. It's the part that I care the most about, because I do think it is crucial to helping democracy get back on its better footing. And I think if you look at trust numbers, for example, people talk about the media, and the problem when you talk about the media is in the States, certainly there are two different types of media. There's national and there's local. And the trust numbers for local media are absolutely abysmal. Not in this country, especially. They're not great for local media, but like more of like 25-26% more people trust local media, which still puts it in the high 30s, low 40s. Don't get me wrong, it's not a great number. But people do trust local media much, much more than they trust national media. And so part of the reason for, you know, spending this much time trying to get local media back on its feet is I do think it's crucial to continuing to do the reporting that allows democracy to flourish.
I might ask Maria Power and Stuart in turn, Stuart Allen in turn, to talk about whether that is the case these days in the United Kingdom as well. Your new prime minister, Liz Truss, seemingly a few weeks ago thought she could build her support and her popularity by going around the evil national media and paying more attention to local media. And I gather this ploy on her part, or attempted ploy, backfired. Maria, do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. So local media really showed its value in that particular instance. And I think before I say anything, there are kind of one thing we have to pre-see this with, is that there is local print media, which in effect has died in this country. And I'm talking about like local town newspapers, local regional newspapers. And then there's the local broadcast media, which by and large is actually publicly funded through the BBC or the British Broadcasting Corporation. And Liz Truss was basically thought that the people that are journalists in the local media on local radio were idiots, and that she'd be able to run rings around them. And in effect, they ran rings around her, and she wasn't even able to answer the most basic questions, which of course produced lots and lots of memes, which were wonderful. But I think they also demonstrated to us the importance of democracy, the importance of local media in democracy, because Liz Truss is prime minister without a mandate. She's been elected by, I think, 0.1% of the British population, with a set of policies that are so far removed from what was voted for, I think, was it in 2019, that she really does need to be held to account. So what the local media did there was amazing. And I think it's one of the reasons why the Conservative government are working so hard to try and defund the BBC.
That would be one way of dealing with the problem. Mm. Stuart, from your perspective, a little bit further from the center, how did all this come off?
Well, I would agree with Maria's analysis there. I think we saw a situation, I suppose in fairness, the arrangement with the radio interviews had been organized well in advance, but they decided to go forward with it. And I think in part because they were anticipating sort of relatively soft questions. And as Maria pointed out, that wasn't the case. I think it was a pretty powerful argument for a notion of the global, that is the sense, the way the global issues converge with the local, and the extent to which local media give voice to people in communities that certainly are don't hold back when it comes to speaking truth to power. I also think it threw into kind of sharp relief the kind of rather cozy, at times, symbiotic relationship between the national media, certainly based in Westminster, and the politicians, in the sense that they need one another. They need a certain degree of kind of cooperation. They kind of collaborate in a rather carefully orchestrated kind of way, with the best intentions on both sides, I suppose. They have a vested interest in ensuring that, you know, they can maintain that kind of dialogue over a period of time. That's not really the case in local media, where they're not expecting to be interviewing the prime minister on a regular basis. So they don't need to hold back, and they can go forward with that. But I think in terms of the larger question you were getting at there, I think, you know, you're absolutely right to point out that liberal democratic values and norms are under attack. We will all have seen, Joe Biden's comments there a little while ago, when he used the phrase semi-fascism to describe the MAGA movement and so forth. And I think that, not to make the point too sharply, but I think he's quite rightly inviting a kind of broader conversation about these underlying tendencies. I don't think we're talking about a fully fledged doctrine there or philosophy. But there are certain kinds of tactics aligned with the far right, which we are increasingly seeing shaping our media dynamics. And I think that they warrant much more attention than they've been typically receiving to date.
Jim, one thing that I think any of us who've been involved in journalism, certainly around Washington in recent decades, if that doesn't seem too long a time frame, have said that very often a fault of the American media is to cover national politics, national affairs, at the expense of local affairs, and especially state legislatures, which have much more day-to-day impact on the lives of citizens than does the United States Congress. But it's harder to cover the state legislatures. Their sessions are not all at the same time. Some of them have very brief sessions and do a lot of damage in a short period of time, then it takes the rest of the year to figure out what they've done. And I just wonder if that isn't more true now. The notoriously, the Obama administration sort of neglected the state legislatures. I think there's a consensus. Right. And so a lot of things happened without the public really knowing very much about what was going on.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly think that's changed for the better in the last 5 years. The sort of rise of the nonprofit news sector here is, I think there's something like 32, 33 states that have nonprofits that are basically covering the state house as either as their primary focus or as one of their areas of focus. And so I think you do see a lot more people covering state houses in the US right now than you did 5, 6 years ago, for sure. I think generally the principle is true. I think, I think at a national level, I mean, this has been a problem in the States for a long time, is that, you talk to political reporters and you say, and I always say this because as someone who's traveled the United States in an RV and lots of other vehicles 4 or 5 times, that political reporters ought to go spend 3 months driving around the US before an election rather than sit in Washington and do big think pieces, get out there and talk to people. And their response is often to say, well, I go to Iowa for a month. Yeah, but you follow candidates into diners. You're not meeting the people of Iowa. You're meeting, you happen to be in Iowa talking to, doing your normal job. And so I think it's a real problem and I also would say that the national local thing to me is the other major difference between national and local news, at least in the US for sure, is that from a business model perspective, the national media is actually pretty incented to divide people. I mean, they're incented to, to get people angry and to get people to watch Fox or MSNBC or whatever and get enraged at watching people, one great person and one jerk argue, whichever side you're on. And there's no real incentive for them to try to be less divisive than they are right now. At a local level, if you look around, like whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, you hate sitting in traffic and you don't want there to be more crime, and you want the local choir that's, on America's Got Talent to win. You want the local sports team to win most of the time. So there's a lot more that people share in local markets. And I think local organizations have also decided, if I'm covering a city of 4 million people, I can't afford to write 2 million of them off by going really hard one direction or the other. So I do think local news has been more traditionally viewed as not necessarily a full-on uniter, because news is not necessarily meant to do that. But I do think there are more shared issues and values that I think gives local a chance to really make some progress in the space. And I think the state coverage is one of the areas where I think people appreciate really good state house coverage, regardless of their point of view. So, I mean, I think local is really the, has to be part of the answer, because I honestly think part of the answer for the national news problem is better local news. That if people would spend more time, had more information in their community they could focus on, they would spend less time watching the cable stations and you know, doom scrolling Twitter. So I do hope that, that as we continue to get local news back on its feet, which I do think we can do, despite the many who think there's no business model for it other than, you know, philanthropy and donors, large donors, I think there is. And I think it's important that we get there for those reasons.
Maria, what lessons do you think the Truss administration, if we can call it that, in the UK, what lessons did she in particular take from this experience with the local media turning out to be much, much more willing to be critical than she expected?
I think the cynical side of me would say she's not taken any lessons, because she's, as far as I'm concerned, on the hard right. But I think that what the kind of incidents with the local media have shown her is that this London-centric view that Stuart was talking about absolutely has to go within politics, and that in order for democracy to actually be something real within the UK, the regions have to be taken into account, and the regions have to be listened to. Now this is quite a kind of common cry on social media, which is where I must admit I get most of my local news from, of there being a north-south divide. I don't actually think there's a north-south divide in the UK. I think there's a London and the rest of the country divide. And I think that everything, if we just look at national media and we rely on the relationships that are built up between politicians and the national media, say between The Guardian and The Telegraph journalists, everything then is, all policies then are going to be framed in terms of London problems, which in many ways are the same. We have knife crime, we have trafficking, we have traffic problems. But then there's also very specific problems to do with kind of rural urban divides, kind of regional issues to do with deindustrialization that governments just don't take seriously because the media don't press them on it. Now, what this incident taught her, and well, I hope it's the lesson she takes, or if, as we're predicting, she goes in the next couple of days, her successor takes, is that the needs and wants of the regions have to be listened to, because there's polls that are coming out now that are kind of saying that Labour is going to sweep the board with them in the regions, which are usually true blue Tory. So I think that's the clear lesson, that they actually have bite and they will use it.
Maria, I just want to make sure I heard you correctly. You said Liz Truss may only last a few more days as Prime Minister. We've just barely begun to learn her name.
Yes, I'm sorry about that. I didn't bother learning her name. So yes, I would say she'll be gone within about 2 weeks.
Wow. Stuart, do you share that prediction?
Well, it's certainly what the political insiders are telling us on a regular basis, that we can anticipate a change in the next, probably within a week or two, certainly between now and the next election. I don't think anyone would be confident that Liz Truss will be leading the Tories into that election. It looks like there'll be some sort of ad hoc arrangement made where there'll effectively be a coronation with certain agreement made amongst members of the Tory party of who they can all live with, compromises made and so forth, and then they'll be presented as a done deal rather than taking it to the membership, which they're otherwise obliged to vote. And that's of course how we ended up with Liz Truss in the first place.
Stuart, when we cast our eyes from a distance on Europe, we see some trends, some patterns developing, and the two most recent ones that come to mind are Sweden and Italy. Italy may be less surprising than Sweden, but quite not just right-wing governments, that would be one thing, but governments that do seem to question some of the fundamental principles of democracy. Now, of course, you could point out that there's a certain very significant political figure in this country of whom the same can be said, the former president Donald Trump. But are there lessons to be learned from these trends in Europe? How do you look at that and the coverage of them?
Yes, I definitely believe that there are lessons to be learned. And I'd like to think that journalism is sort of responding and taking away important things to think about in terms of professional practice. I think it's what's happened in the US with Trump, what's happened here with regard to Brexit, what's happening in other national contexts as you've described, is this kind of taking or appropriating, maybe is a better word, of people's really legitimate anger and frustration, sometimes resentment and the like with their situation in life, and effectively weaponizing, using it in a manner which advances a far right agenda, which someone like myself would say is absolutely inconsistent with the interests of members of the public. And yet, nevertheless, many of them feel that only those parties are actually giving voice or expression to what they are concerned about. And I think journalism, to some extent, journalists have to kind of be wondering to what extent are they in danger of becoming kind of complicit in that project, not intentionally so, but in terms of sort of their taken for granted norms and conventions in terms of how they go about their work. We'll all remember sort of the early days of Trump and how difficult it was for journalists to say, this man is lying. I can remember many a piece in the New York Times, Washington Post and the like saying this is actually, to call a president a liar is not something journalists were comfortable with doing. So they found a number of kind of creative ways to say that without kind of calling it a lie. And that started to change in a hurry, just because of the sheer deluge of misinformation and disinformation that was going on. But at the same time, I would say, looking at things from the other direction, it also invites self-reflexivity about what we actually are calling democratic norms and values. And I think, you know, if we slow down and kind of unpack them a little bit, we recognize to a large extent, certainly the viewpoint of many people, they are predominantly white. They prefigure sort of a male point of view quite often, a middle upper class perspective, the heteronormative in terms of their unspoken or tacit assumptions and the like. And I think in many people's views, especially young people, they don't relate in quite the same way as what we might otherwise anticipate with sort of a more textbook understanding of these norms and values. So when I think when we're talking about journalism, we wonder about its future, and we think about it, especially with regard to young people, I think it invites that kind of questioning, really interrogation of what counts as quality journalism. What are these democratic norms and values, and how best can journalism contribute to their enrichment and improvement? And that's going to make for, I think, some challenging conversations in newsrooms and elsewhere to think very differently about how they're going about reporting.
Jim, there are a number of points that you may want to pick up on, but one I want to try to persuade you to take is whether the media helped create Donald Trump. And there are still many people who think he's over-covered. I mean, he hasn't been president for almost 2 years now, and still there's not a day that he's not in our consciousness.
No, I mean, if you look at the morning newsletters you get from the New York Times or the Washington Post, Trump's still mentioned in much far, far more often than Biden is in those daily newsletters. And so I do think that, you know, I mean, we are somewhat complicit in that there's an administration in power right now that seems to be getting less coverage than Trump gets out of power, which I find kind of fascinating. And I don't think that's constructive either. I mean, I think there's no doubt that I think he was viewed as kind of a joke when he came down the elevator to run for that. And I think he was covered that way, but he was covered a lot that way. And he was willing to go on television anytime somebody called and talk about what he was doing. And so, hey, we can get a presidential candidate on. And a famous one at that, you know? So I think I don't know that there was ever any intent to build him up as a serious candidate, but we certainly helped do it by basically giving him an open mic. And then once he started to actually move up in the polls, and every time he gave a speech, we put it on all, you know, all the network. Not the big three networks, but the cable networks we put him on. So there's no question we helped create him. And I think the real challenge that, you know, I want to also point out one thing too. The trust in the national press in the United States was already in the tank when Trump ran. So I think there's always this, the people don't trust the press because Donald Trump told everybody not to trust the press for the last 6 years. They already didn't trust the press. And so I think there's a legitimate debate about whether Donald, clearly he created more distrust, but did he take advantage of it as part of his campaign? And was that something he saw the numbers and decided to run with it rather than the other way around? Because the numbers have been bad for a long time in the States, really since the 70s, they've been on the decline. And they took some real downturns, kind of the advent of social media in late 2000s. And they've taken a dive since Trump got into the public eye at this sort of uber level. But they were bad already. So I think one of the challenges that we're having in the States in terms of, he was definitely covered differently than, I think as Stuart was pointing out, than previous administrations, where the sheer number of the falsehoods that had to be called out had the press here doing things that being much more aggressive at calling those things out. I think part of the challenge is though now is that then when Biden came in and people thought this was a bit of a resume to normalcy, right? The number of lies that Biden tells are more typical presidential, which is not zero in any way. But the problem with that is there was a whole segment of people who watched how Trump was covered for 4 years who are wondering why Biden is not covered the same way as. I'm not justifying that and saying the number of lies are anywhere close to each other. They're not. But there's a problem of getting those people back to believing anything they read from the press anymore. And that, I think, is a real problem right now. And I think there are a lot of candidates running for the midterms here, which are going to be in a couple of weeks, that have real fatal flaws that will still win. And frankly, on both sides, but there's certainly a fair number of them on the right who might very well still win despite those flaws, because a lot of people on the right just look at it and say, the press can report all the things they want about Herschel Walker. Like, we don't care because we don't trust you anyway. And they go vote for him because they view Herschel Walker as a better alternative than anybody who has a D next to their name. So the partisanship here is really ugly right now. And in a lot of ways, Trump ushered that in as much as he ushered in the distrust of the press. He made everything into a partisan battle in a way that's really stuck with us, and I think in a pretty unpleasant way.
So, Jim, do you think the solution does lie around the country in smaller towns, smaller cities, to try to take back a kind of, somehow put things back the way they were? Is that going to be possible?
I don't know. I think at a local level, it's possible. Yeah, at a national level, until the incentives change, I don't think the behavior is going to change. I think you're going to see division is the main product of the cable stations, because it sells and ratings. You can convert ratings into a lot of dollars. So I don't know that's going to change in those. I mean, it'd be fascinating, frankly, to watch what happens with CNN now, because CNN has decided to make an active path back to the center, which is where they always kind of occupied until Trump, and then they went a little harder left. Now they want to go back, and it's going to be interesting to see what that does for their bottom line, because I think they now see that that's the place where they think they can carve out their own identity. But I don't know if that's going to work at this point, because CNN had a 4 or 5 year period here where I don't think anybody on the right watches them at all anymore, and their ratings have suffered from that. So I just don't know what's going to happen with them. But I hope it works. I wouldn't mind seeing somebody in that place in the center.
May have to rewire the brains of some of the people who work for them, but
yeah. Well, they got rid of a few already. I mean, I think they're going to probably clean more house too, I suspect, because some of the folks, to your point, said it's not going to work. There's no way to kind of it's already out of that train has left the station. But I hope. I mean, that's why we spend so much of our effort funding local news, because we have seen the power that good, strong local news organizations can have in cities, and you can point to research that shows better informed communities are less partisan and less angry. So they focus more on things they can control in their community rather than being mad about something that's going on in the White House that they can't. And so I do think that we have, the decline in local news has really helped foster the anger that a lot of people in this country have right now, because it's when you don't have that much to read locally, you start doom scrolling Twitter and watching the cable stations. And I will tell you from a personal standpoint, I really slowed down my use of Twitter about 2 years ago. And I, other than election night, I don't watch any cable news in this country. And I'm a much happier human being for having done those things. And I think like, but I had to force myself to not do that. I wish I could have done it by just being able to consume stuff that was being written about my community, but there isn't enough of that right now. We need to make sure there's more of it down the road.
Maria, what about in the UK and some European countries, to the extent that you're familiar with what's happening there? Will there be a kind of reclaiming of calm discussion and traditional democratic values on that side as well?
Well, the two markets that I'm most familiar with are the UK and Ireland. And I'm afraid to be very pessimistic, but I don't think there will be a reclaiming of calm. And I think that there are a number of reasons for that, which Stuart and Jim have already started unpicking. But the first of them, I think, is that we lack quality local news. Local news is by and large a bit boring. So I think, for instance, in Northern Ireland, it tends to be quite interesting because of the problems of democracy there and other issues to do with paramilitary organisations and crime. But then if you go to other parts of Ireland, it's about farming and issues that people wouldn't generally be that interested in. And I think that possibly in the last 20 years, certainly kind of as I've come into adulthood, people are increasingly looking to their journalism for entertainment. And they are increasingly losing the facility that I know I was given at school and I was given through the education system to critically evaluate what they're reading. So I have absolutely lost count of the number of friends, mostly female, I must admit, who you could have an extremely lucid and erudite conversation with about politics, economics, kind of world affairs, who read a newspaper called the Daily Mail, which I hope most people have heard of, which is so bad that Wikipedia will not allow it to be used as a footnote because its fact-checking is so bad. But this is where a lot of people are getting their news, because it's written in a really entertaining, shocking way. It's like a Victorian penny dreadful. And people use it as a way of shutting their brain down. And so they're not using their critical faculties in the same way as they would say in a conversation or at work, say they were fund managers or something. And this is actually a massive problem. And in the last, I think, probably about 10 years, you're actually seeing other media outlets doing the same thing. So take, for example, Good Morning Britain, which is the breakfast program on independent television, which is just complete clickbait. You know, there are people having rows with each other and that's presented as news. And there's no, any time that there is, they try to have a political debate, they kind of ape what goes on Fox. And even the BBC News is trying to calm things down. So BBC Breakfast is trying to calm things down, but it's doing it in a really anodyne way. And it does it by not actually challenging in a journalistic way, in the way that I always probably very naively believed that journalists were meant to do, challenging policies that, for instance, are causing deaths, such as the cost of living crisis or the benefits crisis that we're having. But they're doing it in a very soft way but they're basically allowing politicians away with it. And I think one of the reasons people got so excited about what happened to Liz Truss was because they suddenly switched on and realized, well, actually, this is what journalism is supposed to look like. Journalists, kind of in our belief in the UK and certainly in Ireland, are meant to speak truth unto power. And that's what we saw the local radio broadcasters doing. And so I think that what we don't need is calmness, because if the calmness that the BBC National News is giving us is anything to go by, then that's not what we really need. We need robust debate. and we need people that are willing to stand up and challenge. And this is where I would bring in kind of social media activists. So I know certainly in Northern Ireland, which is where I have the clearest kind of picture of what's going on, is there are actually some really wonderful academics, female in the main, who are doing the job of journalists and holding the government, or lack of government, because we don't have a sitting government there at the moment, to account for what they're doing to communities and what the cost of living crisis is doing to the marginalised. And I think that increasingly we're going to see this change towards citizen journalism. And I think that kind of academics who are socially aware and who are working in areas to do with policy will increasingly become the people who are asking the hard questions that journalists really should be asking. But possibly because of that kind of pally relationship that they have, especially within the Westminster bubble, they probably, and in the Stormont bubble as well, and in the Dublin bubble, they're probably not asking. So yeah, I think robustness rather than calmness would be what I would ask for.
I stand corrected on that point. No, that's quite all right. I see your point. Stuart, you have studied citizen journalism, and I must say, I bet Jim Brady had this feeling at an earlier stage too that I had at some point. Well, how dare some of these people call themselves journalists? They haven't worked covering night police. They haven't done some of those vigils outside waiting for news to happen and things like that. And yet there does seem to be more confidence in non-journalists performing journalistic functions.
Yes, I think most of the people that typically are described as citizen journalists in the press or media more generally probably wouldn't self-identify as such. They're people who I sometimes describe as citizen witnesses, and that they happen to be in the wrong place but at the right time, and have the presence of mind to kind of document what's happening in front of them with their usually a smartphone, and then they share imagery or video footage or the like online, also with friends, families, followers on Twitter, Facebook, and what have you. And then that gets picked up and used by the media, who cannot be everywhere all at once and therefore benefit from using this material. And they quite often describe such people as citizen journalists who are sort of on the scene. And I'm not certain that in too many cases people are actually, as I say, self-identifying that way or even thinking what they're doing is journalistic. But that's in contrast with people who do sort of consciously take on that role and with it that kind of responsibility, because they happen to live in a community which perhaps once upon a time, not that long ago, had a local paper, might have been a weekly, but nevertheless focused on that community and its interests and concerns, which is now sort of either fallen by the wayside and disappeared, or it's been converged with numerous other communities, newspapers, to become one which they might then expect to see perhaps a one page or two of sort of community news in a community newspaper, which actually stretches to encompass a much wider geographical basis than it used to. And therefore, a lot of things that people are interested in might be sort of what the local council's deciding about a parking restrictions or zoning requirements or what's happening with schools or local sports and so forth isn't being covered. And so we do see people say, well, actually, I can cover that. So they might otherwise be employed elsewhere, or they might be retired. They might, in any case, they are often volunteers who are saying, well, I'll go along to that local government meeting and I'll sit there for 3 hours and then I'll go home and go online and update my blog, and it will have an image or two, perhaps a little bit of video footage, and I will tell you what decisions are being made, you know, in your name, on your behalf by local councillors. And some people describe this as kind of hyper-local journalism or micro-journalism, but it clearly performs a vital role. For a lot of people to have that sense of actually being in a community, because of course it is local news that I think goes a long way towards constructing that sense of belonging, the sense that we are part of a collective group identity. And so these are some of the almost workarounds you could describe them to make up for the fact that too many local papers otherwise are owned by conglomerates. They're being driven by the interests of hedge funds and private equity groups, not really that interested per se in what happens in communities, as long as the bottom line is satisfactory to shareholders. So we've got a lot of work to do to improve that, but I'm encouraged by some of the points that Jim has been making about how the tide might be starting to change a little in the US, which is very welcome news.
Well, in just a moment, we're going to go back to Mike and he'll take up some of the questions that have come in. So I want to encourage the people who are listening and watching from a distance to put their questions in the Q&A button now. There are quite a few already, but we're always happy to have more. Jim, is there a risk of hyperlocal news as a sort of overreaction to the distaste for the national media?
I don't know. I mean, hyperlocal is one of those terms that it's hard to even define anymore. It's been used so for so long and it's kind of lost its meaning. I don't know if hyperlocal is a block, a town, but I certainly think that, local news, there are a lot of things in local news that are boring, but there's also a lot of things that, are going on around you all the time in your community you do care about. And, we spend a lot of time talking about local news and the focus in the States often turns to these nonprofits that are doing these big weighty investigative enterprise pieces. And those are obviously important because the local papers are not sized to do those anymore. But at the same time, there's also a lot of startups in this country, a lot of them, that are members of like the local independent online news publishers, which has 450 that are going out there and covering things like school board meetings. And, they may seem, well, school board meetings are not boring here anymore, as you might've heard. They got more exciting in the States than they used to be. But they're covering traffic and infrastructure and commercial real estate and why in the restaurant scene and local high school sports. And those things are still important to a lot of people. And maybe most importantly, time spent reading those things and consuming those things is time taken away from the more incendiary things that you can consume in the news space. I do think part of the reason, to Maria's point about why sometimes people want to go for entertainment for news, is they're exhausted by reading actual news because the actual news is so depressing that they would rather go read another soft story on the Daily Mail than read something else that makes them want to stare into oncoming traffic, I do think if we can give more of a supply of more information that is useful and necessary in a community, I think it can help to short circuit, I think, the corrosive effect national news has on people right now. But we have to have more people in the field doing it. There are a lot more doing it in the States right now. I mean, the Lion and INN, which is the Institute for Nonprofit News, those two organizations now have a combined 775 members. And
wow,
years ago, that number was like 300. So they've more than doubled in the last couple of years. And most of those two organizations specifically, their primary focus is on building the business sustainability of those organizations. It's not to train them how to be journalists. It's not to focus on the actual output of the journalism. Journalists know how to do that. Their problem generally is that they don't know how to do anything else. They don't know how to build a business. They don't understand the technology. They don't know what their content management system ought to be. And those organizations are trying to give them tools to say, you know how to do the journalism. Let us help you figure out how to build a business that's sustainable so you can keep doing this. And I think that shift in the last 5 years, which Knight supports completely, like our focus is really sustainability. It's trying to build systems that allow local news to flourish, not to try to pick 10 winners around the country that we think are doing good work. Let's fund the newsrooms. We try to fund the infrastructure so that more sites can launch. And Lion and INN are two of the key supporters, or two key organizations that are doing that work.
One quick additional question, Jim, before we go back to Mike. The culture wars that are consuming this country at the moment, book banning, abortion debate, sexual identity, and all these issues, the culture wars are taking place primarily in the States, in local areas. There are differences among the states, which is interesting for those of us who thought that maybe the regionalism was going away. But Are the culture wars fanned and made worse by the focus on them in the local areas, do you think?
I don't know. I mean, one of the things I have learned, and before I took this job, I did a lot of consulting, including for, a bunch of local organizations, and have generally found that the heat of the debate on abortion is always going to be a heated debate. But for some reason, when you get into communities and people sit around and talk about it in the same room or have a debate about it, it tends to be, literally in the same room, it tends to be a little bit less horrible than it is when people are doing it virtually or doing it on television from two different remote locations. So I think these issues are still thorny. And yes, you can always go find a school board meeting that, descended into chaos. And those are the ones you see on television. But I read a lot of stories about a lot of tense meetings where there was actually a reasonable dialogue about a contentious issue, because I think people just don't treat people when they're physically in the same place the way they do online, or when they do on, when they're on a remote camera. So I do think, I don't think these are still thorny issues, and there's still going to be ugliness around it, but I still think at a local level, when things are discussed locally, it tends to be a little less horrible and soul crushing than it is when you watch it, on online platforms or digitally. So I don't think it's a perfect solution, but I don't think it's as bad when you're physically together than when you're not.
Mike, are you ready to take things back in Oxford and tell us about some of the questions that have come in?
Yeah. Things have been going on since you've been debating it in Parliament. Paddy Mordaunt, one of the cabinet ministers, has actually said that Liz Truss is not cowering under her desk at the moment, refusing to come to Parliament, but she isn't in Parliament, so she didn't say where she is. Anyway, it's all very interesting. Sue Osler, hello, Sue. It's good to hear from you. Asks, Truss's tough interviews with local media journalists help cause her, hopefully, forthcoming fall from grace, or would this have happened anyway but just a little later? Stuart, do you want to take that? Do you think it would have happened a little later, or would have happened anyway?
Yes, I think what we're likened in the press to sort of a series of car crash interviews. I think she did about 8 within an hour, none of which went well. It certainly didn't help, but at the same time, I don't think it really made a difference. Her most recent press conference just lasted a few minutes of sound bites, in effect. She then took 4 questions from the press and again just repeated very basic points that she's said over and over again. That might have had a greater kind of impact, because I think that was the moment when she might have started to kind of complicate the easy assumption that she was on her way out. And she didn't. I can only speculate as to what's actually going on there. But put it this way, I find myself in a very strange situation in that whilst I personally would be very pleased to see her move along, you can't help but feel sorry for her, as a person, to be caught up in this situation and characterized the way that she is. I think often, typically fairly, I think that, the arrogance that kind of underpinned her decisions, the extent to which, whilst claiming to be listening, was clearly doing anything but, has led to this kind of situation. But there is a human being at the end of all of this, and it is a really sad, sorry situation. Having said that, I don't for one moment think that her critics are wrong to be saying what they are saying. Now, this is a desperately radical situation, full stop.
Yeah, as for Alexander, a little overparted, as Shakespeare says in Love's Labour's Lost, that she's certainly not a Cicero anyway in coming to defend in a democratic way. Maria, what is your view on that? Do you think she'd have gone anyway?
Yes, I think that those kind of car crash interviews were clickbait. I think that the second the Chancellor got up and gave what was essentially a libertarian budget, people realised what they had actually got, and they had actually got something that was worse than a return to Thatcherism, which kind of certainly blighted my childhood and blighted the lives of many people. So I actually think it's her policies that have done for her. I don't think it's her performance in the media. And I think as well that a lot of people are very angry that she has put in place a series of policies that they didn't vote for, that she's taken the Conservative Party so far away from the 2019, manifesto that we just can't countenance it. And that's why we're seeing Jeremy Hunt allegedly rolling back the budget. Although I'll be very interested to see what he does next spring with it.
Yeah, but Stuart's point is a good one. She's a human being who's actually being humiliated in public, and there's always a sadness about things like that going on in civilization. Caitlin Mackay asks, for both the US and the UK, how can the public support and promote local journalism? I think that's one for you, Jim.
Yeah, I mean, I think they're to give, I think, is the answer. One of the things I've been most critical of about local media over the last 20 years is sort of an unwillingness to acknowledge the trouble that they're in. We're very proud, and local media had this long history of, you know, they would lay 15 people off, but then couch it as part of our grandmaster digital transformation plan, when it was no such thing. It was, we can't afford to have these 15 people anymore. We're getting smaller, we're making less money, and our margins are, you know, gone. More of an ownership of the fact that we need public support to stay afloat. If we had done that 10 years ago, we'd be in better shape right now. But now I think there's more of an understanding that, A, you have to address your audience, you have to cover things they care about, and then I think you can get them to give. And I think there are, you know, whether it's a subscription model or a membership model, which are two different things. Subscriptions are you pay for access, and membership is I give because I love what you do. And this is not, it's not an access restricted thing. We're starting to see a rise in both of those things pretty dramatically here. So, and there's a research about to come out here that we helped fund that shows that young people are actually starting to signal a willingness to give to news organizations that they read that has not existed before. And give meaning donate, not pay a subscription fee. Young folks still are not interested in subscriptions, but they are interested in giving to things they care about. And that number was it's one of the really nice pieces of data that we saw in the initial data. And I think what that means is local media has to continue to appeal to its audience, but that audience needs to give, and the news organization needs to tell them all the time that they need them to give. If you go back even to The Guardian, I think when The Guardian launched its first sub donation thing, it was so like, hey, we hate to bother, do you mind if we bother you for a second? It was like, no, we are The Guardian. We do this amazing journalism, give to help. You know, it was a little bit they were backing into it, and now it's at the end of every story and it's all over everything on the site. You cannot miss giving to The Guardian if you read The Guardian. And I think news organizations here are starting to get that you need to tell people you need to give, and you need to answer their needs, their information needs to get them to give. And so there's a nice uniting of business model and journalism. And if I could take 1 second just to say that one of the real problems in the US, really in digital journalism altogether for 20 years, was a complete misalignment of business model and need. When your goal is to make as many page views as possible, you do the Daily Mail. When you want to cover a local community in a way that actually informs them, you're not going to get those kind of page views. So we got away from doing really good local journalism to get page views, because we needed page views for us to make money in the digital world when we had an ad model. Now that we don't have an ad model anymore, now we're focusing on things that actually get people to give money to the organizations because they like the work, which means for the first time really in the history of digital, the business model and the editorial model thrive the same way. And I think that's been a major, major change.
And you said the Guardian newspaper in Britain used to be called the Manchester Guardian, and I'm old enough to remember it as the Manchester Guardian. I can remember going down on the back of a motorbike driven by my mother's cousin down to Manchester Guardian's offices to do something or other. But it was the Manchester Guardian. We also had the Birmingham Post. These were national newspapers that seemed to be forced to the capital. John, do you, or Maria, do you want to say anything about that? Can we force them back into the regions so they're national within the regions? These are two big cities in the UK, as from UK standards.
Well, the thing I was going to say as well, in Ireland, we had the Cork Examiner, which is now the Irish Examiner. And I've lost count of the number of kind of regional newspapers that have gone, like the Connacht Times and things like that. I think you're right. I mean, I was trying, while you were speaking, I was trying to remember if Oxford had had its own kind of regional newspapers. I think the BBC tried to do that by moving to Salford. And I think to a certain extent that's worked, certainly within the religion broadcasting, which is the one I'm kind of closest to, because it's the one I work with most closely. You certainly see greater diversity of voices and greater diversity of kind of religious news being brought out. But I think that is something that definitely has to happen. But whether the paymasters, who, and it generally is kind of hedge funds or big kind of rich people who own papers, will allow that to happen is kind of in the lap of the gods. And I'm very pessimistic and don't think it will. I think that increasingly what will happen is that you will see news, but not news in the way that we would understand it, moving on to apps like Nextdoor or Facebook. I don't know if you have Nextdoor in the States, but it's an app that gives you kind of access to your local community. And I know that I certainly access a lot of my local news about planning decisions, parking, schools, and they are things I care about, and they are things my neighbours care about, from that app, rather than reading the kind of the Barnet Times. So I think that there has to be change, and we have to move with the times. But yes, I lament the demise of the Manchester Guardian in the same way that you do, Mike.
Yeah, thanks for that. Of course, BBC have just moved out of Oxford. They had studios in Oxford and they moved out. You know, John, do you want to make any statements? Stuart, sorry, do you want to make any statements about that?
Yes, I would agree. I think there is a growing recognition that quality journalism is expensive and someone has to pay for it. And I think the Guardian's model is working. They are now an online first news organization. I think there's plenty of evidence that suggests that, as Jim is indicating, that there is a shift underway, a paradigm shift of sorts, really, in terms of funding. And I think that's really important. At the same time, though, in a local context, Facebook groups and the like are, to a large extent, taking the place of the local paper and ink edition of a paper. And I think that there we've got to be more, we've got to be bolder, really, in thinking about how best to shift that dynamic, whereby at the moment it is the distributors of news which are making the money, not the producers of the news, to the extent that's necessary to sustain them. And I take an active interest in what's happening in Australia, for example, when you look at what the government has been trying to do with Facebook and Google, to say you are going to have to start sharing the profits with the content makers that you are otherwise benefiting from. I know other countries are taking a look at that. The EU is taking a look at that. I haven't heard that the UK government is as of yet, but some of us are encouraging to think in those lines. Because there, is one of many different kinds of possibilities that would help to kind of underwrite the costs of local journalism. I think too, we there's a danger that we become fairly mostly defined within a commercial kind of set of parameters. And I think when you look in other national contexts, you see the extent to which state involvement, either directly or indirectly through a number of other kinds of means, can again help to kind of create a diversity of media and provision in communities which otherwise would be very narrowly cast in purely commercial terms. And I think that kind of subsidy, information subsidy, news subsidy and the like can be really important. We've mentioned the BBC in this regard. I mean, in talking about the local media and its issues with trust, of course, those were BBC local radio stations. There's almost no independent news provision in commercial radio in the UK. And that too is something which regulatory adjustment or two go a long way towards addressing. So there's plenty of scope to do positive things here. And I think there is a desire to see it, convinced that people want to kind of see a better level of news provision at the local level than they have. But we need to kind of get campaigning and push this forward.
Thanks. Let's move to the US now and looking at something. So we can gain contrast from one country to the other. Micah Koliska says, following up to the question, if the media helped create Donald Trump, what should or could the media have done differently to cover him? I'm going to go to Jim, but I'm also going to go to Sandy on that one. Jim?
I mean, I think it was say no to, you know, don't feel like you have to cover every single thing he does. I think there was a period there where when he was, there was a fascination with him because he was a celebrity. So he got a lot more coverage than anybody else who just announced a presidential run who was not already pretty well known. He got coverage nobody else would get. And then that helped him as he started to bump up, as his message started to resonate with some number of people, then they decided to put him on because he was surging in the polls. And so I think some of it is you don't want to tip the scales quite that much. Nobody else was getting that kind of coverage. So some of it, I think, is not going back to the old fairness doctrine that we used to have here, but it is a little bit of trying to make sure that you're giving candidates, trying to give them as much as you can, the ability to get to the airwaves and get their message across, because there were an awful lot of people who barely got mentioned at all, who kind of came and went from the race. I mean, Jeb Bush, for God's sakes, and this was a governor of a huge state in this country, who was the son of one president and the brother of another, like that he could barely get any coverage during the Trump period. And this is a guy who, so I mean, I do something is you just have to take your foot off the gas. But again, why was Trump on the cable stations all the time? The ratings were good and they made money. And so sometimes you do have to remember what your goal is in journalism is to try to educate the public and not purely just to drive as many dollars as possible, because Donald Trump's still driving dollars for the cable stations right now. And that's part of the reason why he still gets so much airtime. So I think that's part of the answer is just remembering sometimes that we have a responsibility to the citizenry to try to present as many different points of view as possible in the presidential election. And we didn't do it last time.
Sandy. Mike, in response to your invitation, I'd say I agree with everything Jim has just said. And I think it's all true. We didn't have to wait a long time to figure out what happened with Trump. But I do think there's one other factor. I think he has mastered the art of intimidation. And I have seen how many people feel the need to defend themselves against Trump. I mean, when he said they're the enemies of the people, there was this powerful instinct to say, we are not the enemies of the people. He's wrong. He's being unfair to us. And of course, that's exactly what he hoped to provoke. And I remember the moment when I think it was Steve Bannon and Trump came out and said, well, the media are just a part of the opposition. They're the opposition party. And of course, that's the way it often has ended up being in the last 50 years anyway in the United States, is that sometimes there was not very much meaningful opposition in Congress to the Vietnam War, for example. There was almost none. And so the media and the students and the people in the streets forced changes in policy. And I mean, I was struck at the time when Bannon and Trump said that yes, it was true. But they were afraid of being called that, and understandably so, because that's not what it's meant to be. So I think Trump's techniques are very well rehearsed and very successful. And it's even though I do think I agree that the media helped make Trump, I do think that it's very hard to resist. It's very hard to figure out how to handle that. And when it's packaged with so many outright lies, you have to figure out which ones you're going to take on at any given time. I mean, the Washington Post counted the number of lies. It's in the hundreds of thousands by now, I think. And so who cares anymore? That's what he does. And he was successful with it.
He's not the only one, Sandy. We had somebody who told us that we had an oven-ready Brexit, which was far from oven-ready.
Of course.
Stuart a bit earlier gave a good example of some British irony when he denied something about Britain. But have a look at the recording of that. Well, that was very good. So, can I just go to this one? Local, this is John Alto. Local broadcast news in the US includes happy talk and trivial stories, making them easily dismissed. Where can we get local news of substance, Jim?
Well, I think you're starting to see some changes in the local TV space. There are some organizations out there that are starting to recognize that if it bleeds, it leads doesn't work when you get to digital platforms, essentially, and that people, you know, they don't want to go to their local TV news website or get their morning newsletter and basically have it be a list of everybody who died in their city since they went to bed, because that's what a lot of those sites are right now. There was a shooting, there was a fire, there was, you know, and a lot of this, the more progressive stations are starting to get to the understanding that they need to adopt things like solutions journalism principles, which is, let's not write about another shooting, let's write about what's being done in this community around, you know, how gun control, right? Let's talk about the issue, step back a little bit and talk about, or if it's police, how are police being trained to deal with traffic stops in the light of a local shooting, instead of just reporting on the local shooting. So I think I'm not saying this is widespread yet, but there are really smart local TV companies here like Gray and Graham, Scripps, that are doing a lot of experimentation around how to actually make their report more like what the newspaper reports of 25 years ago looked like, which was more coverage of local government. And yes, there's always going to be happy stories. And I, for one, I'm happy to support an occasional happy story. I think I do think sometimes we're like, you know, any story that's a happy story is something that's not journalism. Well, I would disagree with that. I think you do want to write stories about people doing good things in communities, because that starts to remind people that not everything going on around them is catastrophic. There are good people doing good things. I'm not saying that should be your entire report, but I think it's part of a mix. So I do think you're starting to see some change in the States. And I will tell you this, they're still the most trusted local news entities in most cities as local television or public radio, which are very different things. But a non-newspaper entity or a non-text entity is the most trusted organization in most U.S. cities right now. And they need to figure out how to take advantage of that, because the content, especially on the commercial TV side, needs to change if they're going to maintain that, I think.
We're starting to run out of time. I want to, Simone Shaney asks a question. What role do PR professionals have in helping save our democracy and all the detailed issues surrounding democracy on a local level? And Emma Benzinger, who's an MBA student, says, my impression is that their priority is usually the journalism product first and creating a sustainable business second. I'd be curious to hear your view on why making money comes second. It's necessary for their survival, but it seems like they're not willing to invest in talent or experiment with new revenue opportunities. Those are kind of general issues for both the States and the UK. Maria, do you want to have a little go on that? Either of those?
I would probably take issue with the idea that newspapers put journalism first and then money second. I hope I've picked the question up right. But I think, for example, of the Evening Standard, which was kind of the newspaper to read when I was a student, it was a London newspaper that you bought at the tube station on your way home. And it had some wonderful journalism and it had some wonderful news. It got the balance between serious and happy, but not silly, right. And then it got bought out by, I think it was The Independent, it was certainly kind of one of the Irish media conglomerates that bought it out. And they changed their model overnight towards making profit from ad revenue. So it started to be given away free. And it overnight, it literally became a rag. You wouldn't even kind of use it to soak up, you know, your freezer when you were defrosting it. It was that bad. But so I would take issue with that. I think that that profit for most of these papers actually comes first. And that's why I find The Guardian so refreshing. And that's why I find the kind of media content that I'm getting on Twitter from kind of activist citizens so refreshing, because they're editorializing in an intelligent way, even if I disagree with them. And they're actually kind of trying to highlight the truth and tell the stories of ordinary people, which I think is the thing that's lacking. You were talking earlier about not having very much sympathy for Truss. Well, I don't have very much sympathy for a woman whose policies are actually going to kill people. And that's what's being highlighted to me through this kind of activist journalism, which is showing the impact of her policies on people. So I would dispute that question and say that the mainstream media is trying to make money, and it's profoundly damaging democracy.
Stuart, your view on that?
Yes, I think too, it comes down to our sense of profitability. It wasn't that long ago where, you know, the owner of a commercial news organization, local press and so forth, would assume a reasonable rate of return was maybe 2-3% a year on their investment. Now, because of the different political economy of the local press, I mean, my local newspaper here in a small town in Wales is owned by an American company, Gannett. The expectations of what constitutes a reasonable profit have changed dramatically. It's got to be a much higher return on that investment in order to keep shareholders happy and the like. And that in turn then, I think, necessarily distorts the necessary investment that needs to be there in creating a good quality news product. And we sort of then are in danger kind of falling into a rather unpleasant, vicious circle, really. And that is, people then think, well, there isn't enough in the local newspaper for me to bother picking it up and paying for it. And therefore, their knowledge of what's going on in their own communities suffers, their own degree of civic engagement and awareness of others and issues that are there for the community weakened. Their own sort of sense of trust and sort of institutions diminishes, and around that goes. And so we've got to kind of break up that cycle. And I think that it is a question of investment at the end of the day, and creating kind of spaces where communities can see themselves being represented in all of their diversity and all of the richness of local cultures that so often at the moment are being trivialized or ignored.
Thanks for that. Jim, can you?
I mean, I think, yeah, I would agree with Maria. Newspapers' problem has never been that they're not focused enough on business. I think for many, many years, they were focused on making their margins as high as they possibly could. And now the focus is on making sure they have any margin at all. But, and I think, I think for a long time in the States, the additions that were made to new, you know, one of the things you hear a lot, I will say, is that X newspaper used to have 400 people and now it has 80. And that's, the numbers may be right, but if anybody worked in newspapers in the 80s and 90s, know that a lot of the expansion of newspapers was special sections like health and travel and home and food that were done because they could make more money. They weren't necessarily things the audience was asking for. They might have liked some of the stories in there, but it wasn't, those 400 people were not all covering the local community. You know, maybe 100 of them were actually out in the field covering the community. So when we talk about the drop in the newsroom staffs, a lot of it, the news gathering numbers are generally have not dropped quite as much as the overall numbers have, but the overall numbers are very, you know, very awful and often the ones that get the attention. So I think those days are gone now. And now the focus is, how can we just make enough money to keep going and produce enough journalism to have value for the readers? And it's a struggle. I think, you know, we have one of the challenges a lot of the big legacy papers in this country have is they still have paywall models, which I get. I understand why you want to have a paywall. I understand why you want to charge $5.99 a month for your work. But I find it odd that the minute a hurricane starts to approach a major U.S. city, what's the first thing that news organization does? Pulls down the paywall. And they say, well, why? It's like, well, this is information people need to have. And I'm like, that's probably information people need to have every day. But, you know, when at a moment in which you're about to get the biggest audience you're going to have all year, you actually take down the revenue model because you understand at the end of the day, you have to serve the community first. And so we need to get back to a world in which that's the focus on more days than just the days a big hurricane is coming. And I think we're starting to get there. I think you're going to start to see a lot of news organizations shift from a subs model to more of a membership model like public radio has here, because it doesn't cut off access and it does drive you more toward public service journalism. So that's a prediction that I hope comes true.
Well, let me, I'm going to bring this to a close now with just a yes or no question. Do you therefore, Jim, think there is a sustainable future for local newspapers, local media? Yes or no?
Yes for local media, no for local newspapers. I mean, I think newspapers will convert to digital, but I don't think the print model is going to sustain for the long term.
Maria?
Yes for local broadcast media, but no for local newspapers, same as Jim.
Stuart?
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I think I'd be tempted to kind of take the theme of our discussion today around local media, you know, help save democracy, and say that it's really important that democracy helps to save local media.
Yeah.
Well put. Very good. Very good. Sandy, over to you. What's your view? Have we made sure that local media also...
Well, I think we've had a great discussion, but probably put too little emphasis on public radio in this country. I have my own background in public radio. It was important in forming my attitudes about these things, but public radio has done a remarkable job of waking some communities up to very important issues over time, not just the national broadcast, but local public radio stations as well. Some of them do a remarkable job. And I think there is a future there. I think Jim is right in terms of membership, a membership organization, or convincing people they have a stake. And we have had a very unusual thing in Washington, D.C., where a public radio station has taken over and caused a local news source, it's not a newspaper, but a local digital news source, to thrive. And I think this has gone on in some other cities as well. So that, and it's been a challenge to some of the more establishment newspapers that this could happen digitally. So I think I agree in general with the consensus. And I think one of the ways to go is this notion of public radio in the public interest. But I think we have to wrap up, Mike. So I'll jump ahead of you and say thanks to everybody who has spoken so eloquently with us today, and also the people who have tuned in and who will tune in later to see this discussion on video on various Georgetown University and other websites. Thanks, as usual, to our funders and to Georgetown for all the support we've had to keep this free speech project going. This is a very important part of sustaining free speech in our two countries and many others, to keep the media free and accessible and innovating as they need to do in order to remain relevant. So thanks to all.
Well, thank you. Thanks to Jim Brady, Maria Barrett, Stuart Allen. Thank you very much for such an enjoyable debate. Got a lot of information through. We're sorry one of our panelists, Victoria, had to drop out just before the schedule, so or last night actually, so before we started. I'd like to thank Sandy, who some of you might know and some of you might not know, was in a former profession with the director of Voice of America. And an extremely important radio broadcast that we remember well. And I gather has come back after Trump finished it off. They brought it back, if I'm not incorrect.
It's coming back.
Voice of America is coming back. So there we are. The next Free Speech Project at the Crossroads International Dialogues event will be on Monday, the 14th of November. And we'll be talking about life after Putin, Russia and the West. something that I think we all need to tune in on. I would I'd also like to mention on the Tuesday, the 1st of November, in the Bent and Beautiful World Arts, Literature and Environment series, Anna Dini Morales from Georgetown University will be introducing to us the Chilean poet Gabriela Mistral. I also want to remind people that there is a conference in Oxford on the 13th of December, free to all, which is bringing to a close our Christian Literary Imagination series. And Mary Gordon from Georgetown will be sending you details if you're on our database in the next few days, giving you information as to how you can enroll. But for those of you in the United States, Claire Broom Saunders and I will be coming over to the United States in February for a public lecture at Georgetown, linked to the end of that series. I also want to say thanks to colleagues at Georgetown, Jack DeJoy, the president, Tom Banchoff, the vice president, at Blackfriars, John O'Connor, the regent, Richard Finn, the director of Las Casas Institute, at Campion Hall, Nick Austin, the master of Campion Hall, and Trudy Preston and Ying Ying, our Campion Hall administrators. Also, real thanks to John McCabe in the US, Laura Lees, my UK publicist, for the way they get these things on the air, and to Maggie Scott, who does a lot of the administrative work over here. So thank you all for attending today. I hope you've enjoyed the debate and discussion as much as I have. It's been a wonderful afternoon. Watch British politics. It's rather interesting at the moment and might get more interesting over the next 2 weeks. You know, as someone who's just risen to the sun, gets burnt by it, perhaps, and falls. I'm Professor Mike Scott, Fellow and Senior Dean at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. You can follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Until next time, take care, keep safe, look forward to seeing you again. Goodbye.